Again, on our important topic, that is approach to inborn errors of metabolism. Am I audible, Rishi?
Yeah, please carry on.
Okay. So we will first look at the approach to inborn errors of metabolism. We think of inborn error of metabolism when we have these problems in the newborn. When we have a newborn with altered sensorium, unexplained seizures, when you have a newborn with refractory or prolonged hypoglycemia, when you have a newborn with unexplained metabolic acidosis, then when you have a newborn with liver cell failure or cholestasis, newborn with abnormal odors, and those with abnormal skin and eye findings, and also with miscellaneous presentations. So you look at these syndromic presentations and then try to tease out the etiology of IEM. So what will happen is altered sensorium or seizures. So when you have a child with altered sensorium seizures, you think of IEM when it is an uncomplicated pregnancy, the baby is well at birth. Normally, these babies present on second and third day of life, that is after a substrate exposure. And the classical clinical features are unexplained vomiting. This is vomiting, not regurgitation, projectile vomiting, sudden loss of consciousness, decreased sensorium, seizures, multiple recurrent seizures, tachypnea, and sometimes hepatomegaly. These are the common features of most inborn errors of metabolism. They are well at birth. They present on second or third day with rapid progression. And most of them will have altered sensorium with seizures and tone abnormalities. In Dr. Ramesh's presentation, we have learned that when you have hypertonia with altered sensorium, you should think of metabolic disorders. And one more important history is when you have history of consanguinity or when a previous baby is affected. Now, when you have this presentation, even then, the common problem should be always be ruled out. And the common problems mostly are sepsis, because baby could have a perinatal risk factor which you would have missed, and baby could have planned up with early onset sepsis or delayed sepsis after 48 hours or late onset sepsis after 48 hours in this same manner. Or it could be a metabolic disturbance like hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, hypo and hypernatremia, sometimes in summer dehydration fever with acidosis and metabolic disturbances, and also sometimes intracranial hemorrhages. So these problems should be always be ruled out, because most of the times inborn errors of metabolism is a diagnosis of exclusion. Now there are five common metabolic disorders which presents with altered sensorium and seizures, and these five inborn errors of metabolism are categorized as hyperammonemic or urea cycle disorders, organic acidemias, maple syrup urine disease. Maple syrup disease is a amino acidopathy, non-ketotic hyperglycemia, and molybdenum cofactor deficiency. In all of them, the presentation is very similar. That is, they are well at birth, altered sensorium, seizures, second or third day, and rapid deterioration. This is a classical hallmark of IEMs. Now, you have to tease out which of these five is the problem in this particular newborn. So after ruling at the common things, hyperammonemia, when do you think? You think of hyperammonemia, the newborn presents with altered sensorium, seizures, vomiting, hepatomegaly, and hypoglycemia. You do a screening, you will get hyperammonemia, hypoglycemia as an important findings. One very important characteristic feature is metabolic alkalosis. And they have tachypnea, probably because of hyperammonemia. So metabolic alkalosis, hypoglycemia, hepatomegaly, altered sensorium, seizures, vomiting. These are also classical features of Reye syndrome in a child. So if you have a presentation like Reye syndrome in a newborn, you should think of urea cycle disorders or hyperammonemias. So when do you think of organic acidemias? Again, same presentation. Well, baby deteriorates on second or third day with altered sensorium, seizures. But other important features of organic acidemia are severe metabolic acidosis, They could have shock, they could have leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, and they will have exactly like a septicemic picture. A gram negative septicemic picture is the presentation of organic acidemias. So hyperammonemia, race-like picture, organic acidemia, septicemic-like picture. Now, what about maple syrup urine disease? Again, day two, day three presentation, altered sensorium, seizures, vomitings. Very characteristic feature of maple syrup use, they will have mild acidosis, but you do urine ketones, they'll be strongly positive. Moderate to heavy ketones in the urine or blood ketones are strongly positive. And some of these children could also have hypertonia. And we have also seen on the MRI, these children or these newborns have hyperintensity in the myelinated areas of the brain. In a term baby, these are posterior limb of internal capsule, the brain stem, and the parts which are myelinated have hyperintense signal in the maple syrup urine disease. But for you to remember, you should think that mild acidosis, but severe ketones, altered sensorium, seizures, hypertonia, you should think of maple syrup urine disease. Non-ketotic hyperglycemia, this is quite slightly different variation from the other three, that this could present even on day one. And many of them could have in utero seizures, abnormal movements, history of abnormal movements when the mother was pregnant, the last trimester. Baby starts having seizures on day one. And some of the clinical features which will make you think of non-ketotic hyperglycemia are opsoclonus, myoclonus, and hiccups. Hiccups with altered sensorium seizures, you should always think of non-ketotic hyperglycemia. These children usually do not have acidosis or alkalosis. Absence of alkalosis, acidosis, no lab clues, and mostly they will have only opsoclonus, that is abnormal eye movements, myoclonus, and also hiccups. Molybdenum cofactor deficiency usually does not have neither clinical clues, this has neither clinical clues nor many laboratory clues or diagnostic parameters. But we have learned that maple syrup urine molybdenum cofactor deficiency should be considered when you have a newborn with altered sensorium, seizures, again no acidosis, no alkalosis, no hypoglycemia. But babies have one very important lab feature, is very low levels of uric acid. If uric acid levels are low, molybdenum cofactor deficiency should be considered. And we have learned from Dr. Ramesh's lecture, again on the MRI, these children have typical presentation of a HIE. So they could have exactly like HIE feature on the MRI. So just to elucidate on the same five differentials, hyperammonemia presents mostly after 24 hours, mostly in male babies it is severe, and in females, because it is X-linked dominant disorder in females, it can be, presentation could be milder. Altered sensorium seizures, hepatomegaly, hyperammonemia, hypoglycemia, metabolic alkalosis. So one very important differential in a urea cycle disorder is TAN, transient hyperammonemia of newborn. TAN is a type of urea cycle disorder, but we should differentiate it from other urea cycle disorders because this presents on day one of life. This presents mostly in late preterm infants, and this is transient. So if you treat the hyperammonemia rapidly or on an emergent basis, many of these children should come out without any sequelae. To confirm what is a urea cycle disorder, we have to do urine orotic acid and aminoacidogram. Now the second presentation I told is organic acidemia. Again, vomiting, altered sensorium, seizures, respiratory distress, mostly because of severe acidosis. They have shock. And this picture is very similar to a septicemia. And as I said, they could have neutropenia, leukopenia, and thrombocytopenia. Metabolic acidosis is one very important feature. These children could have both hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia. And they also have the metabolic acidosis in organic acidemia contributed by organic acids, ketosis, and lactic acidosis. All three types of acidosis are present in organic acidemia. These children also have hyperammonemia. So if you have hyperammonemia with acidosis, you should think of organic acidemia. If you have hyperammonia with alkalosis, you should think of hyperammonemic or urea cycle disorder. The three common organic acidemias are isovaleric acidemia, propionic acidemia, and methylmalonic acidemia. So these are the three common ones. And we have again seen that MMA, that is methylmalonic acidemia, and propionic acidemia have classical MRI features that is basal ganglia hyperintense signals. They could have abnormal odor and skin rash. One very important diagnosis of organic acidemia should always consider is multiple carboxylase deficiency. This organic acidemia also always have a skin rash. So in organic acidemia with skin rash, you should think of multiple carboxylase deficiency. Why we should think of it? Because it is responsive to biotin. And subsequent diagnosis of organic acidemia, to differentiate one from the other, you do plasma amino acidogram and urine organic acids. The third presentation of IEM as altered sensorium is maple syrup urine disease. We have already discussed this. They will have mild to moderate metabolic acidosis, but severe ketosis or ketonuria. One very important bedside test is urine ferric lauric acid is positive in maple syrup urine disease. They may have this sweet, malty, caramel-like odor. Non-ketotic hyperglycinemia may present on day one with in utero seizures. There is no acidosis, no ketosis, no hyperammonemia. So whatever we've seen in the previous three categories is absent here. They could have hiccups, myoclonus, opsoclonus, and diagnosis is by high CSF to glycine ratio. So molybdenum cofactor deficiency, it presents with unexplained altered sensorium, progressive encephalopathy, no lab or clinical clues, but very important, clinical or important simple test is decreased uric acid. As I said, in the synthesis of uric acid, molybdenum is a cofactor, and hence you will get low uric acid in molybdenum cofactor deficiency. Ectopia lentis could be a feature of molybdenum, but usually appears after the neonatal period. So there is characteristic feature of each one of these IEMs. So you should look for those characteristic features to make a diagnosis of IEM. So just to recap, a race-like picture. I want you to think before I open up. Race-like picture, hyperammonemia. Sepsis-like picture, organic acidemia. Ketosis or ketonuria, maple syrup urine disease. In utero seizures, opsoclonus, hiccups, NKH or non-ketotic hyperglycinemia, low uric acid, molybdenum cofactor deficiency, lens dislocation, sulfite oxidase deficiency. Molybdenum and sulfite presents very closely with each other. So that is the picture of IEM presenting as altered sensorium or seizures. The second common syndromic presentation of IEM is hypoglycemia. So you think of IEM when you have refractory hypoglycemia. When do you say baby has refractory hypoglycemia? When the blood sugars are less than 40 and your GIR is more than 12 milligram per kg per minute. In these conditions, you should think of persistent or refractory hypoglycemia. And this hypoglycemia lasts for more than 2 weeks. So very difficult to control hypoglycemia. You think of inborn errors of metabolism. But the common types of hypoglycemia occurs in diabetic babies, babies born to diabetic mothers, intrauterine growth restricted babies, babies who are premature, and those with infection. These common things should be ruled out before we think it is inborn error of metabolism. Now the other causes are hyperinsulinemia, fatty acid oxidation defect, glycogen storage or gluconeogenic disorder, and endocrine disorders. Now, how do you differentiate all the other causes? So whenever you have persistent hypoglycemia, you rule out the form common varieties like IDM, IUGR, premature infection. Then you think of the IEMs and inborn errors of metabolism. And these are very simple. When you have hypoglycemia or when your sugar is low, body should try to compensate this by using fats. And during hypoglycemia, if fats are utilized, you will get urine ketones. The end product of fat is ketones. So fats are utilized, then you get ketones. But when there is hypoglycemia, if fats are not utilized, then there are no ketones in the urine. So the first step to differentiate persistent hypoglycemia is whether you have ketosis or not. Non-ketotic hypoglycemia is hyperinsulinemia and fatty acid oxidation defect. Non-ketotic hypoglycemia is hyperinsulinemia and fatty acid oxidation defect. Ketotic hypoglycemia is glycogen storage, gluconeogenic disorders, and endocrine disorders. Glycogen storage, gluconeogenic, endocrine disorders like congenital adrenal hyperplasia, growth hormone deficiency, and hypopituitarism. So non-ketotic, hyperinsulinemia, fatty acid oxidation defect, ketotic, glycogen storage, gluconeogenic, endocrine disorders. Now let us try to tease out one from the other. So if it is non-ketotic, then you look at insulin levels. If insulin is high, it is hyperinsulinemia. If insulin is normal, then it is fatty acid oxidation defect. So non-ketotic hypoglycemia, hyperinsulinemia is hyperinsulinemia. Non-ketotic with normal insulin is fatty acid oxidation defect. In ketotic, one of the very important differentiate feature between endocrine and glycogen or gluconeogenic disorders is lactate levels. If lactate levels are elevated, most likely we are dealing with glycogen storage or gluconeogenic disorders. If lactate is normal, then we are dealing with endocrine disorder. And all of us know how to differentiate one from the other endocrine disorders. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia, you could have hyperpigmentation in a male child, hyper or ambiguous genital or the disorder of sexual dysgenesis in a female child. And you could have growth hormone deficiency presenting as micropenis, growth hormone or hypopituitarism presenting as micropenis. So just to carry on with this, non-ketotic hyperinsulinemia or fatty acid oxidation. Differentiation between these two is by insulin levels. Now in hyperinsulinemia, it is very important to differentiate whether it is a beta cell hyperinsulinemia or glutamate dehydrogenase activating enzyme. So if it is a glutamate dehydrogenase activating enzyme, this hyperinsulinemic condition which presents as prolonged and refractory hypoglycemia is responsive to diazoxide. So glutamate dehydrogenase activating enzyme responds to diazoxide. So when you have hyperinsulinemia, non-ketotic hypoglycemia, look at ammonia. If ammonia is elevated, think of GLUT1 deficiency, GLUT1 activating enzyme, because this responds dramatically to diazoxide. In ketotic hypoglycemia, I've already told you that normal lactate indicates endocrine disorder and high lactate means gluconeogenic or glycogenic disorder. Organic acidemia could also present like this, but we know that organic acidemia most likely will have all other presentations like altered sensorium, seizures, septicemia, acidosis, many other features are there apart from presenting only as persistent or refractory hypoglycemia. I want you to bring to your notice one important disorder of glycogen storage disorder, that is Van-Gerg's disease. All of you must have heard about Van-Gerg's disease. This presents usually after the first 1 month of life when the feeding duration increases. When the time between two feeds increases, then the glycogen storage disorder starts manifesting. So that is why the Van-Gerg's present usually in the infantile time as chubby baby, hypoglycemia, hepatomegaly, soft hepatomegaly, and early morning hypoglycemia, that is during the fasting period. So this is one of the very important causes of SIDS apart from MCAT. So hypoglycemia, you have to do this basic investigation, that is insulin, ketones, fatty acids. If ketones are low, and do look at ammonia, because hyperinsulinemia, hyperammonemia is glutamate dehydrogenase activating mutation. Hyperinsulinemia, hypoglycemia, and low ketones or non-ketotic is the beta cell defect, what we have to think of here. And the other thing, if you are low ketosis, high fatty acids, you have to think of fatty acid oxidation defect. But if your ketones are high, then you have to differentiate between lactate. High lactate is glycogen storage, gluconeogenic, and normal lactate is endocrine, that is hypopituitarism, growth hormone deficiency, or adrenal insufficiency. So this is what I was showing, that you get problems. This is a beta cell of the pancreas. So when glucose enters the cell, the potassium channel closes, depolarization occurs, and then calcium enters into the cell and then causes release of insulin. So you could have hyperinsulinemia when there is a problem in the this potassium channel or sulfonylurea gate. But the other way hyperinsulinemia occurs is activation of glutamate dehydrogenase. Glutamates get converted to alpha glutaglutarate. This changes the balance from ATP to ADP, or the balance increase ATP to ADH ratio occurs. This again causes depolarization and insulin release. So in glutamate dehydrogenase activating enzymes, ATP to ADH ratio is increased by the conversion of glutamate to alpha-ketoglutarate. That is why you get hyperammonemia. And since diazoxide acts on the potassium channel, which blocks this channel, you can get good treatment of glutamate dehydrogenase activating enzyme presenting as hypoglycemia, it will respond very dramatically to thiazoxide. Now, this is how you measure the penile length from the base of the penis to the tip. Normally, you expect it to be at least 2 to 2.5 centimeters. So this is one important diagnosis. Presents at birth, large babies, hypertrophy, large tongue, organomegaly, and ear creases. So what is the diagnosis? So it is a case of Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome. Yeah, I think some people have already written it. It is a Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome. Okay, now in hypoglycemia, you have to look at blood or urine ketones. So ketotic and non-ketotic. In non-ketotic, you have to look at insulin and then ammonia to differentiate beta cell from GLUT1 activating enzymes. And non-ketotic, non-insulin is fatty acid oxidation effect. In ketotic, the differentiating feature is high lactate, normal lactate. Normal lactate is endocrine, high lactate is glucogen or glycogen storage disorder. Now, the third type of clinical presentation or syndromic presentation is presence of unexplained metabolic acidosis. If you have metabolic acidosis, which is unexplained, you think of inborn errors of metabolism. Now, you have to remember that for newborn, there are only four things which causes metabolic acidosis. So, one is loss of bicarb or retention of hydrogen ions, which occurs in renal or GA causes. The other thing is retention of keto acids, lactic acids, and organic acids. So it is important to differentiate whether it is a GI or GI or renal causes versus retention of other acids, that is keto acids, lactic acid, and organic acids. So differentiating renal GI causes from the other three acids, you do anion gap. If your anion gap is normal, then you think of renal or GA causes. If your anion gap is increased, then you think of ketoacidosis, lactic acidosis, or organic acidosis. So we already discussed in the other day, if there is severe metabolic acidosis, if anion gap is normal, we have to think of kidney, like renal tubular acidosis, or GI, lower GA causes like diarrhea or cystic fibrosis. And Dr. Mehul had told us that urinary chloride is a very important differentiating feature to differentiate renal acidosis from renal to GA. So what he said is, if it's a renal, there is chloride loss in the kidney. If it is a GI, there will be chloride retention. So chloride is considered as an acid. So if there is loss of chloride in the kidney, it is a renal disorder. If there is no chloride loss in the kidney, it is a GI disorder which is causing metabolic acidosis. Now coming to the other three acids, whether it is ketoacidosis, lactic acidosis, or organic acidosis. So if you have metabolic acidosis, but no ketones, severe metabolic acidosis, but no ketones, again, remember the point that in metabolic acidosis, you should get ketones. If there are no ketones, most likely it is non-ketotic metabolic acidosis with increased anion gap. Again, here you'll think of fatty acid oxidation defect. Both in hypoglycemia and in metabolic acidosis, if urine ketones are absent or blood ketosis is not there, very likely it is a case of fatty acid oxidation defect. Now, if you have ketosis, you have to think of, if ketosis is associated with hyperglycemia, then it is diabetic ketoacidosis. If the ketosis is there, if significant, then you have to rule out lactic acidosis. If lactate is very high, I've already said that lactate is very high, more than 90, then we are dealing with mitochondrial disorders or pyruvate carboxylase deficiency or pyruvate dehydrogenase deficiency. If lactate is not very high means it is less than 10 millimoles per liter or less than 90 milligram per deciliter. Then you can see high lactate in organic acidemia also. Now let us try to tease these differentials again. But basically, when you have metabolic acidosis, you have to first differentiate whether it is normal or increased anion gap. And then you have to differentiate whether it is ketoacidosis, lactic acidosis, or organic acidosis. So first step of our metabolic acidosis, is it normal or increased anion gap? Anion gap is sodium plus potassium minus bicarb minus chloride. If your normal anion gap is less than 12, then you are dealing with renal or GI causes. And these causes are renal tubular acidosis, cystic fibrosis, or diarrhea. In diarrhea and cystic fibrosis, urinary chloride will be low. In renal tubular acidosis, chloride will be high. Urinary chloride will be high. Now, the second thing is urine anion gap. Increase anion gap. If increase anion gap, next you have to think whether it is with ketosis or without ketosis. And then subsequently look at the lactate and ammonia, you will get the diagnosis. So if you have metabolic acidosis without ketosis, we are dealing with these three conditions: fatty acid oxidation defect, HMG coalized deficiency. Both are some defects in keto acid synthesis or utilization of fatty acids. Pyruvate dehydrogenase deficiency usually presents as metabolic acidosis without ketosis, but there will be severe hyperlactemia. Now with ketosis, you have to think of organic acidemia, mitochondrial disorders, glycogen storage, gluconeogenetic and congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Now, how do you differentiate this from lactate levels? If your lactate levels are high, then based on the lactate levels, you differentiate organic acidemia from mitochondrial disorders. In organic acidemia, there will be metabolic acidosis, there will be ketoacidosis, there are organic acids, and there will be lactic acidemia. But organic acidemia also has hyperammonemia. Whereas mitochondrial disorders have mostly lactic acidosis, and the levels of lactate acidosis are usually more than 10 millimoles per liter. Now, lactic acid levels and ammonia will differentiate organic acidemia from mitochondrial disorders. Now, how do you differentiate the first two from the last three is by looking at the hypoglycemia. If you have hypoglycemia, metabolic acidosis with ketosis, think of glycogen storage, gluconeogenetic congenital. Again, we have already seen how to differentiate gluconeogenetic disorders from congenital adrenal hyperplasia, where endocrine disorders do not have lactic acidosis, and glycogen storage and gluconeogenetic disorders will have lactic acidosis. So among the organic acidemias, we have already seen this. In MSUD, there will be mild acidosis but severe ketosis. And in organic acidemia, there will be acidosis, ketosis, lactic acidosis, hyperammonemia, and low calcium, and other features, differentiating features are already help you to make a diagnosis of organic acidemia. But when you have severe acidosis, you have to differentiate, you have to consider lactic acidosis, because primary lactic acidosis, called congenital lactic acidemia, is most likely because of pyruvate dehydrogenase, pyruvate carboxylase, and electron chain defects. Here the lactate levels are more than 10, and often we think of lactic acidosis means tissue hypoxia. But in tissue hypoxia, lactate will increase, but ketones are usually absent. Dysmorphism is a feature of PDH, and we have seen some MRI findings of PDH in the lecture on MRI. Now, in lactic acidosis with hypoglycemia, think of gluconeogenetic or gluconeogenetic disorders. So, to summarize, metabolic acidosis with increased anion gap, first do urine ketones. If urine ketones are negative, think of fatty acid oxidation defect or HMG coalized deficiency. If urine ketones are positive, do urine sugar. If there is positive, then it is transient diabetes. If urine sugars are negative, do organic acid and amino acidogram. Rule out amino acidopathies or organic acidemia. If you're ruled out that, then lactate up to pyruvate ratio. Lactate to pyruvate ratio is elevated in mitochondrial, and it is normal in glycogen, gluconeogenetic, and pyruvate carboxylase endocrine disorders. So just to recap the metabolic acidosis, anion gap differentiates renal and GA from inborn errors of metabolism. Ketosis differentiates between fatty acid, HMG coalesce, and PDH, that is pyruvate error, from the other causes. Hypoglycemia and ketosis is a feature of organic acidemia, glycogen storage, fructose 6, and CAH. Lactate to pyruvate ratio differentiates mitochondrial disorders from the electron transport defects from pyruvate dehydrogenase and pyruvate carboxylase deficiency. Now, the fourth presentation of inborn errors of metabolism is liver cell failure or cholestasis. Now, let us look at cholestasis. Now, whenever there is unexplained cholestasis without any clinical features, no hepatomegaly, nothing else, enzymes are normal, then you ruled out all other causes. in one of the things is unconjugated jaundice. Unconjugated jaundice, you think of Crigler nausea. In cholestatic jaundice, you think of Dubin-Johnson or Roberts, Rotor syndrome. In unconjugated jaundice, prolonged unconjugated, not responding to any therapies, and prolonged jaundice, you think of Crigler as a type 2. But if it's cholestasis, the carbohydrate disorders are galactosemia and fructosemia. Protein is tyrosinemia. Lipid is Niemann-Pick type C. Cystic fibrosis, alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency, iron metabolism, hemochromatosis. Now, hematochromatosis is now considered as gestational as alloimmune liver disease, peroxisomal disorders. These are the disorders, IEMs, which presents as cholestasis. Now, before going in depth, I just want to tell you that each one of them has a characteristic feature. Cholestasis in galactosemia presents with cholestasis, hepatomegaly. Urine culture will show E. coli, and there may be cataract in these children. And here, galactosemia, the hypoglycemia is onset with feeding. When you feed the baby, they will have hypoglycemia. When you stop the feeds, put them on IV fluids, hypoglycemia may settle. Fructosemia usually does not present in the neonatal period because there is no exposure to fructose in the neonatal period. Usually presents after 6 months when you start adding sugar to the diet or to the milk. Tyrosinemia most often presents as severe liver cell failure. It is not just cholestasis, but it will present as liver cell failure. And one very important feature, mild tyrosinemias may present with cholestasis with proximal renal tubular acidosis. So they will have proteinuria, they will have glucosuria, they will have phosphaturia. And Niemann-Pick type C, you should think of, this can present only as cholestasis without liver cell failure, but one very important clinical feature is presence of cherry red spot in the eye. Cherry red spot, cholestasis, you should think of Niemann-Pick type C. Cystic fibrosis, although a rare presentation, but it can have. So that presentation should always be considered. Yesterday we have seen that in one of the presentation, we have seen that it can present only with metabolic acidosis also. Now, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency can also present as liver cholestasis. Hemochromatosis, now it is considered as a case of gestational alloimmune thrombocytopenia. Both can present as liver cell failure. Peroxisomal disorders usually have dysmorphism, hepatosplenomegaly, hypotonia. They will also have other features which will help you to make a differential diagnosis. Now, among the ones which are underlined are the ones which are present as liver cell failure. So how do you differentiate cholestasis from liver cell failure? If you have elevated liver enzymes, that is, if you have PT-APTT markedly prolongated and it is not responding to your vitamin K, then we say it is liver cell failure. The other features of liver cell failure are presence of encephalopathy and ascites or severe hyperammonemia also. So presence of coagulopathy, ascites, encephalopathy, hyperammonemia will tell you that this is a liver cell failure. In the absence of that, you could have hepatosplenomegaly, elevated enzymes, hypoglycemia, and other features except what I mentioned, means it is only cholestasis. So some people differentiate as a sick baby and a well baby, but I prefer to do it as liver cell failure and non-liver cell failure. So if you have liver cell failure in the first 1 week of life, very likely it is GALT, that is hemochromatosis, mitochondrial hepatopathy, and disseminated herpes. Now, usually herpes is a perinatal infection. That is why it will present usually after 4 or 5 days of birth. It doesn't present at birth. It presents after 4 to 5 days, whereas GALT or hemochromatosis can present even at birth. The second and third week liver cell failure is galactosemia and tyrosinemia. For both of them, you need substrate to be built up. That is why they present initially with mild cholestasis and they end up with liver cell failure, sepsis, secondary infections, hypoglycemia, and in tyrosinemia with renal tubular acidosis. After 3 weeks, you will see bile acid synthetic defects, hepatitis B, or hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. This could be primary or this could be secondary to an infection which occurs in the first 1 or 2 weeks. But in liver cell failure, now important is galactosemia to find out because this is treatable. GALD is important because this again is treatable. Secondary HLS also you should differentiate because this is treatable. Viral also is treatable. So whenever you have liver cell failure, first think of GALD because GALD is responsive to immunoglobulin. 1/3 of the cases of GALD respond to IVIG. So this presentation is very classical. You should be able to make this diagnosis very easy because they present at birth, mostly in preterm or IUGR babies, they do not have hepatomegaly. Unlike the other liver cell failures which happen in the neonatal period, this does not have much of hepatomegaly. Severe coagulopathy. And another very important feature is the enzymes are not elevated. They are not markedly elevated, usually less than 100 international units per liter. So no hepatomegaly, severe coagulopathy, and having liver cell failure in the enzymes not markedly elevated, ferritin elevated between 800 to 7,000 nanogram per ml. We should think of gestational allometal liver disease. And one another important feature is alpha fetal protein elevated. Now viral will always, that is herpes presents after fifth day, they will have hepatosplenomegaly, they will have, sometimes herpes can also have renal proteinuria, renal failure also, proteinuria could be a feature, and there could be skin lesions sometimes, they have severe encephalopathy also. HLH, I said, usually presents with, again with hepatosplenomegaly, markedly elevated enzymes. Enzymes are markedly elevated both in viral and HLH, and here you will see that they could have bone marrow suppression, like they could have anemia, leukopenia, high ferritin levels, very high ferritin, even more than what you see in GAL. Mitochondrial disorders can also present with liver cell failure, but again, there they will have hypoglycemia, they will have lactic acidemia, and they can have hypotonia, and some of the mitochondrial disorders can also have cardiomyopathy. So that is for the liver cell failure and liver disorders. So though IEM, we have discussed about presenting as altered sensorium, then hypoglycemia, then metabolic acidosis, then cholestasis or liver cell failure. Some other presentation of IEM are dysmorphism. Among them should remember the paroxysmal or Zellweger's, pyruvate dehydrogenase deficiency. There are mild subtle deficits like epicanthal folds, long philtrum. But Dr. Ramesh told you that MRI very useful in pyruvate dehydrogenase, where it will tell you that there could be small, the corpus callosum is not well developed, and periventricular flare or periventricular hyperintense signals could be there. Mitochondrial disorders, hypotonia, hypoglycemia, lactic acidosis, and mild dysmorphism. Glutaric acidemia type 2, the presentation is not at birth, but they develop acquired macrocephaly. Smith-Lemli-Opitz syndrome, again, I remember this as a syndrome which will have syndactyly and abnormal genitalia, DSD, and cholesterol abnormalities. Lysosomal storage disorders like Hunter, Harler, they will have coarse feces, and sometimes these can present as in utero high drops also. One another IEM which presents of high drops is disorders of glycogen. So the orders, these are mostly theoretical, but some of them could be important clues like CABG, tyrosinemia, maple syrup or sweet smell is maple syrup, sweaty feet, glutaric acidemia. So, but they could be useful if they are present. Ocular finding, cataract, all of us know galactosemia, paroxysmal disorders, infantile cataract, mitochondrial disorders, retinitis pigmentosa, all of us remember the A beta lipoproteinemias, mucopolysaccharidosis, and cherry red spot. I told you about cholestasis with cherry red spot, think of Niemann-Pick type C. Other very important diagnosis of cherry red spot is GM1 gangliosidosis. Another important skin marker of GM1 gangliosidosis is extensive mongoloid spots. Hepatosplenomegaly, coarse feces, extensive mongoloid spots, and cherry red spot, GM1 gangliosidosis. Optic atrophy, mitochondrial disorders, Canavans, Krabbe's disease, lens dislocation, molybdenum, and sulfate oxidase deficiency. So cardiomyopathies could also be, whenever you have arrhythmias and cardiomyopathies, you should always think of IEMs, because fatty acid oxidation defect can present as cardiomyopathy, mitochondrial disorders can present as cardiomyopathy, and Pompe's disease. All of us know that Pompe's presents as the ECG is very classical. There are tall waves or tall T waves and QRS waves are seen in Pompe's disease. One very important IEM feature is refractory seizures. And I'm sure there is going to be a lecture on Monday, that is tomorrow, by Dr. Lokesh. But whenever you have uncontrolled refractory seizures, pyridoxine should always come into your mind. Pyridoxine dependent and pyridoxine resistant. Pyridoxine dependent seizures respond to pyridoxine. Pyridoxine resistant seizures respond to pyridoxal phosphate. Folinic acid responsive seizures, biotin responsive multicarboxylase deficiency, and magnesium responsive seizures. magnesium, biotin, folinic acid, and pyridoxine. These are the four molecules you have to remember when you have refractory seizures. One more cause of refractory seizures, although not in the neonatal period, it presents little late in the neonatal period, after the neonatal period, is GLUT1. So glucose transport deficiency, that presents a severe hypoglycoria, that is CSF glucose is very low, blood glucose is normal, and they respond to ketogenic diets. So MRI, we have already discussed what are the MRI diagnosis of IEMs. MSUD, you should see restricted diffusion pattern of the myelinated areas of the brain. Propionic acid, methylmalonic acidemia, you should think of bind, bilirubin. So it exactly presents with hyperintensity in the basal ganglia. Glutaric acidemia, this is again very important diagnosis, presents mostly in the infantile period, but there the sulcus spaces are markedly increased and sylvian fissure is very wide. There is one classical feature is cyst in the sylvian fissure as well as bite basal ganglia. So this is a case of maple syrup urine disease because you have the posterior limb of ventral capsule affected, brainstem and cerebellum. So these are the areas which are mostly myelinated areas of the brain in a term baby. This is the case of propionic acidemia or methylmalonic acidemia, where you have basal ganglia hyperintense signals. Again, there could be seen in connectors and carbon monoxide poisoning. This is the picture of a glutaric acidemia, where you have the sylvian fissures very wide and cyst in the sylvian fissure, and you have wide sulcal spaces in this condition. They also have macrocephaly. So always remember the treatable IEMs. Hyperammonemias, think about TAN, transient hyperammonemia of newborn, because this could be responsive to your peritoneal dialysis or restricting feeds or phenylbutyrate or sodium benzoate and protein restriction. Urea cycle disorders, again, some of them like ornithine transcarbonylase in a female could be responsive to liver transplant. OTC liver transplants are known. Maple syrup urine disease, again, there is good diet available. You can control for some time, and liver transplant is almost a therapy for MSUDs. Multiple carboxylase deficiency, biotin. Folinic fatty acid oxidation defects, avoid fasting. You can use carnishore, you can use CoQ along with avoid fasting. HMG coalase, again, avoid fasting, use carnishore and CoQ. Galactosemia, galactose-free diet. GLUT1 deficiency, ketogenic diet. So remember that the treatable causes in each variety, whether it is acidosis, whether it is altered sensorium, hypoglycemia, liver cell failure, always think of the treatable causes of IEM, and that will help us to treat many children or many newborns. Some tests which you normally do, TMS is done as a screening test to find out or to screen for organic acidemia, amino acids, and free fatty acids. But if you want to look for urea cycle disorders, the best is to do urine tests, that is urine for organic acids and urine orotic acids. Enzyme assays are usually done for biotin deficiency, GALT, and lysosomal storage disorders. HPLC is done for plasma amino acidograms. Serum ferritin, so this is what I was talking about, disorders of glycosylation. This presents as high drops in the newborn. So here you look for specific thing, serum transferrin isoform for glycosylation are looked for if you are thinking of glycosylation disorder. And now you have molecular genetic testing if you think of a particular disorder. So to summarize, hyperammonemia after ruling, encephalopathy after ruling the common causes, think of hyperammonemia, that is race-like picture, organic acidemia, sepsis-like picture, MSUD, think of ketosis and hypertonia, NKH, no clinical clue, no major metabolic disturbance, but they have opsoclonus, myoclonus, and hiccups, molybdenum cofactor deficiency. Most of the clinical and lab clues are not there, but a very simple test, that is uric acid, is very low. Hypoglycemia, divide it into ketotic and non-ketotic. In non-ketotic, differentiate hyperinsulinemia from fatty acid oxidation defect. In hyperinsulinemia, always think of hyperammonemia because GLUT1 activating enzyme responds dramatically to diazoxide. In the ketotic hypoglycemia, think of organic acidemia, glycogen storage, and gluconeogenic disorders. And these are differentiated from lactate levels and endocrine disorders also. So differentiation of these two from endocrine is from lactate. Lactate is normal in endocrine disorders. So severe acidosis, again, ketotic acidosis, non-ketotic. First is anion gap, In increased anion gap, ketotic is, non-ketotic is fatty acid oxidation defect. Ketotic is organic acidemia, mitochondrial, glycogen, and gluconeogenic disorders. Differentiation of mitochondrial from organic acid is the level of lactate. It is very high in mitochondrial, normal or moderately elevated in organic acidemia. Glycogen storage, acidosis, and hypoglycemia is features of glycogen storage and gluconeogenetics. Cholestasis, galactosemia, and tyrosinemia, fructosemia, glycogen storage, Niemann-Pick type C, cherry red spot, cystic fibrosis, and hemochromatosis or GALT. Refractory seizures, think of pyridoxin, folinic acid, biotin, magnesium, and in slightly infantile age, also think of GLUT1. Orders and eye findings, dysmorphisms are the other clues. And we had a wonderful lecture where MRI also gives clues for diagnosis of metabolic disorders. So thank you for a patient hearing. And now we'll take the questions. We will take the questions for another, now it is time is
8:46.
So another 10 minutes, we'll take the questions and then we'll move on to the next lecture after the discussion, after the break. Pausing.
Srini.
Yeah.
What is the cause of metabolic alkalosis in aminoacidemia?
No, in metabolic alkalosis is a feature of hyperammonemias. It is a feature of only urea cycle disorders. Both in MSUD as well as in organic acidemia, you will have metabolic acidosis. Okay. So only when you have if you have metabolic acidosis in urea cycle disorders, that means it has gone in for tissue hypoxia. That is late stages of urea cycle disorders.
Okay. And
but mostly they will present initially with alkalosis.
Is urine ferric chloride test available?
Yes, it is available, but you need to probe with the biochemist to do it. It's a very simple test, bedside test. And I've got it done in many times in Hyderabad too.
What is your experience of sirolimus in persistent hypoglycemia?
What is it?
Experience of sirolimus in persistent hypoglycemia. Do you use
okay,
it?
So something like octreotide and sirolimus, these are used for hypoglycemic treatment. And if you remember, they work on potassium channel or calcium channel. So either they have to work on potassium sulfonylurea channel or on the calcium channel. That is how all these medicines work. So what happens is potassium channel closes, depolarization, calcium channel opens, insulin gets released. So you work on potassium channel or on calcium channel. If you work together, then you will get less insulin production. And that is what we do in all hypoglycemias.
Workup of refractory hypoglycemia.
Yes.
Would you suggest 2 weeks period or earlier?
Okay. So I said there are 2 weeks. If you have refractory means one is 2 weeks. The other means severe hypoglycemia not responding to your very high GAR. When your GAR goes more than 12 mg per kg per minute and still you are not able to control the sugar levels, then you should think of IM as one of the differentials.
And you talked about urine ketones. Do you mean qualitative or quantitative?
It is better to do quantitative ketones, but now it is very bedside tests or ketosis is available. You have cards by which you can look for blood ketones. So these tests are often done in the pediatric units for diabetes. In diabetic ketosis, most of the PICUs have this. So use them. There are bedside ketone tests, point of care. You can get the levels of ketones.
In extreme preterms with persistent metabolic acidosis, do you suggest looking at bicarb loss and the pH of the urine?
Okay. So I think metabolic acidosis in a extreme preterm is the cause is totally different. It is mostly because of renal immaturity. So our focus should be more on renal immaturity, correcting hypoglycemia or correcting the acidosis by giving bicarb or by giving lactate containing solutions. That is what happens when you have severe metabolic acidosis. If you are giving some of the fluid can be isolate P. So that isolate P has some amount of lactate which help in bicarb regeneration. So, or if it is not working, then you might have to add bicarb. But there I don't think IEM will come as a primary diagnosis.
And in these extreme preterms, what acidosis value would you consider? -5 or -10? Basic.
It keep varying. I mean, it depends upon the what is a bicarb level. Normal is around 22 to 24. Okay. In preterm, it is taken as 16 to 18. But in extreme preterm, it can go up to 14. bicarb.
Okay. And is the anion gap same for extreme preterms, or you have different values?
No, as you go down, the anion gap can be higher.
Okay. Any practical tips for collecting sample for serum ammonia and serum lactate?
I think all these metabolic disorders, sample collection is very crucial, whether it is hyperammonemia, whether it is lactate. So these are very crucial. If you miss on them, most of the time we get erroneous values because the lab, the sample has not been collected properly. So you should ensure that both for ammonia and lactate, these two are very important tests. Hyperammonemia, if it is borderline, you cannot say whether it's hemolysis or because of real high ammonia. So it should be immediately sent, or frozen sample should be sent.
Arterial or venous?
Venous, always venous, free flow venous sample.
Another question is, does the IEM behave differently in twins and triplets?
It depends upon the, it depends upon the genetic component. If you could have dizygotic twins, one could be affected, other could be non-affected, or a monozygotic twin, both could be affected. So it depends upon the genetic component.
What would be the IV fluid of choice for suspected galactosemia?
Okay, so I think whatever fluids you give in galactosemia, it is all right. You have to give only, the diet should be off lactose. So once your lactose-free diet is given, galactose sugars become normal, and you have to control the secondary infection because most of them will have E. coli sepsis.
In a HBsAg positive mother, is there a role of doing a LFT in a newborn at say 1 month of age or follow?
No, because what they are saying is in HBsAg positive, give immunoglobulin and vaccine immediately after birth, preferably as early as possible, but up to 72 hours you have a choice. Most of this presents after 3 weeks. I told you that in case liver cell failure is because of perinatal transmission, it's only after 3 weeks. But most of the time the presentation is at 6 to 9 months of age.
What is the cutoff for ammonia values for diagnosing UCD in the neonatal age group?
To diagnose what?
UCD in the neonatal age group.
So ammonia values are multiple levels are there. If it is more than 1000, very likely you're dealing with urea cycle disorder. But if it's somewhere around 300, 400 or 500, most likely it is organic acidemia. But in urea cycle, I said it is alkalosis. In organic acidemia, it is acidosis.
Which IEMs would have basic tests normal?
I told you NKH, molybdenum cofactor deficiency. These will have, usually you will not get multiple clues, but clinical clues are very useful in NKH. So history of in utero seizures, abnormal movements, presentation on day one, and I told you about the hiccups. Hiccups is very characteristic feature. In fact, if you search the YouTube to Google, we have presented a classical case of NKH where we have demonstrated a opsoclonus.
And what values would you take as cutoff for lactate?
Lactate is very difficult because I told you that for considering as IEMs, we take it about anything more than 5 millimoles is significant for IEM. But 2 to 5 could occur with tissue hypoxia also. Two times normal.
Okay. In suspected Beckwith-Wittmann syndrome, how long would you give diazoxide?
I've not managed a case of Beckwith-Wittmann, but it's a disorder which is congenital. So I think it should be there for long. I can see Dr. Ramesh Konanki is there. Maybe he might have an experience on managing Beckwith-Wittmann. Ramesh, do you have an experience? How long you give diazoxide in... Dr. Ramesh, are you there? Hello? No. Okay. So I think it should be lifelong. But we had a case of hyperammonemic hyperinsulinemic hypoglycemia, that is GLUT1 activating enzyme deficiency, where we had to continue more than a year. And even after a year, the child was on a very low dose of diazoxide. And diazoxide has two important side effects. One is the hypertrichosis. Second is weight gain or water retention. So sometimes you have to use a diuretic along with diazoxide if there is water retention and inappropriate weight gain.
And there's one query which says that there is a newborn who got admitted with hypoglycemic seizures. The CSF study was normal. It was hyperammonemia 334. Lactate came high and urine ketones are positive.
So organic acidemia, you have to think of organic. All the three are elevated means organic. So you have to send for urine organic acids and plasma aminohistochrome.
Okay. And so the bottom line appears to be that all newborns who are sick should have a differential diagnosis of IEM always.
I think all sick newborns, you should think, because most of that, it is said that 10 to 20% of septicemias admitted to the NICU are actually IEMs.
Okay. Would you suggest that we should do urine for glucose, non-glucose reducing substances as a screening tool for all hypoglycemic babies?
If you have persistent hypoglycemia, yes, it is urine reducing substance. Many people confuse it stool, but it is urine. If urine reducing substance is positive, and if, see that again, the way it is done is you have to do a Benedict test, not a glucose stick. So if glucose stick is negative and urine reducing substance is positive by Benedict's, then it is galactosemia.
And any practical tips on biotin supplementation?
So biotin, as I said, is refractory seizures. You should think of biotin as one of the differential. And if you think of organic acidemia with rash, then biotin supplementation should be given. It is one tablet once daily. So crush it and give it.
Any role of serum and urine osmolality?
Urine and serum osmolality. I don't know which condition.